Hey there, entrepreneur, and welcome to today's show. We are keeping with the holiday spirit, and today we are bringing you the gift of fun. Today's guest has been dubbed the Marie Kondo of brains by the New York Times. She is an award-winning science journalist and speaker, and she is the author of two books. The first one that I'm going to mention is coming out in December, and we will have all the information for you on that one. And it is called The Power of Fun, How to Feel Alive Again. And her other book, which you should also pick up, is called How to Break Up with Your Phone. And now I'm going to give you a website, folks, that you're going to want to go visit, because she's also the creator and founder of screenlifebalance.com, which you're going to want to go see because it's dedicated to helping you scroll less and live more. So Catherine, thank you so much for being a guest today.
Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah. I mean, why not? I mean, tis the season, man. We need more fun in our lives. And then we also need to break up with our phones. All of the things that you preach, I'm a big fan of. So let's jump right in about things. You know, I was reading the advanced praise, so congrats on a lot of that. And I saw Adam Grant's quote on this delightful book might just be what we need to start flourishing. And I couldn't agree more as I read through it. But give us a little bit more background, you know, about your life. What sparked your first book, How to Break Up with Your Phone? And then, you know, what inspired you to jump in the fun arena?
My first book, How to Break Up with Your, or the first book that you're referring to, How to Break Up with Your Phone, was inspired by a personal experience I had with my daughter, where she was born in 2015. And as a side note, like I have a background in mindfulness and try to be a self-aware person. But I had this moment with my daughter where I was feeding her in the middle of the night, and I had this out-of-body experience where I could see the scene as if I were outside my own body looking in. And I saw this dark room with this woman sitting there with her baby, and the baby was looking up at her mother's face, and her mother was looking down at her phone.
Yeah.
And that made my heart sink. I just was devastated because I knew that was not the impression I wanted her to have of a human relationship, and it was not how I wanted to live my own life. So it was really a wake up moment for me, despite the fact that I was like falling asleep in the moment, where I decided that I wanted to do something about it. I wanted to change. I didn't want that to be how I was spending my time or interacting or not interacting with my daughter.
Yeah.
And I also realized that at that point in 2015, 2016, there was beginning to be a little bit more of an awareness that there were negative effects of our relationships with our smartphones and technology, but there wasn't a good guide for what to do about it. And it wasn't at all as much of the conversation as it is now. So I decided that I would write a book about it. My previous book had been about the history of vitamins, and that was sparked by just a curiosity about nutrition and my own experience living with type 1 diabetes, which I was diagnosed with when I was 22. So this was like my new personal issue that I decided to turn into a professional project. So I ended up writing How to Break Up Your Phone, which I love this cover. This was the—
I do too. That's great.
Yeah, the text bubbles. But I wrote How to Break Up With Your Phone, which combines a look at the science of what our phones and our devices are doing to us and how they're designed to hook us. It combines that with a 30-day plan to take back control. So that's what How to Break Up Your Phone is about. But what I realized personally is that that really was only the first step. So the motto I came away with when I wrote How to Break Up Your Phone is our lives are what we pay attention to.
Yeah.
With the idea being that we only experience what we pay attention to. We only remember what we pay attention to. And that means anytime we make a decision in the moment about how to spend our attention, we're actually making a much broader decision about how we want to spend our lives. So that was really meaningful to me and has helped guide my own personal decisions in my life. But what I realized is that once you, quote, break up with your phone, which to clarify, I don't mean dumping your phone and not having your phone anymore, but rather having a healthier relationship with technology, you're going to end up with a lot of time because you're going to reclaim the minutes and hours that we each fritter away on our phones each day. And what I realized is that I had lost sight of what I wanted to do with that. So my husband and I had gotten in this practice, which I recommend that people try for themselves because it's really interesting and actually quite rejuvenating and useful, of taking 24-hour breaks from our screens from Friday nights to Saturdays.
Great.
As kind of a digital Sabbath. And there was this one Saturday where I was actually sitting in the— I can see my couch right from where I'm speaking to you.
Yeah.
Where I was sitting on the couch and our daughter was napping and my husband was out doing some errand. And I was sitting here alone thinking, I've got a whole hour in front of me. I can do whatever I want to with this hour. How amazing. Like, how often do you have that in early parenthood? And I couldn't think of a single thing that I wanted to do. My mind was totally drawing a blank. Didn't have a book I wanted to read. I didn't have a hobby I wanted to do, nothing. And so I quickly started to catastrophize, and I decided that meant I was really just waiting to die. Yeah. And it freaked out. So I'm like, oh, that's not how I want to live my life. Just
die.
So I asked myself this question that I'd been posing to people when I was researching how to break up with your phone. And the question was, what's something you always say you want to do, but you supposedly don't have time for? And my answer to that question was, well, I always say I want to learn how to play guitar. My grandmother gave me money to buy a guitar in college. She played guitar herself. I was really close to her. I've played piano since I was a child, so I have a musical background. Never gotten around to playing the guitar. And then I remembered I'd seen a flyer in my neighborhood for this children's music studio where there actually were adult classes, these BYOB super casual adult classes. And so I signed up for one when I was back online. And I started going to this class, and it was so interesting. It was, as I said, very casual group of other adults, mostly parents. We definitely learned how to play the guitar, but I realized that I was experiencing this energy and this sense of exuberance that could not possibly just be due to the fact that I now knew how to play more chords. Like there was something bigger going on. And I noticed also that the effects of the class lingered for days afterwards. I felt happier and more energized and more alive just as a result of this hour and a half with these adults I barely knew playing an instrument none of us were particularly good at for no purpose. And I asked myself, well, what is this feeling? And I realized as I thought about it, oh, it's fun. Like what I'm experiencing is fun. And I had a pretty, and I have a great life. Like I am quite happy and content with my life. And I was having fun, but I hadn't thought about it in this way. And I wasn't having enough of it. And as soon as I pinpointed the experience I was having as fun, I became obsessed with trying to figure out what is that? Like, what is fun? How can I have more of it? And then the science journalist in me became very curious about, well, what is it actually doing to me? So I, as I just mentioned, gotten really interested in the effects that our interactions with our devices are having on us. And in many cases, those effects are quite negative, like way more than we even realize. Yeah. And I became curious about whether or not fun might actually be the antidote to all of those negative effects. And that where the things we do on our screens are bringing us down and raising our stress levels in ways that are negatively impacting our physical health, could fun be doing the exact opposite? So all that is to say, that launched me on a new project, which is the book you're talking about, The Power of Fun, How to Feel Alive Again. And similar to my last book, it combines a look at the science of fun and exploration of what it is and what it does to us. It combines that with a plan for how each of us can actually have more of it. And I'm so excited this book is coming out. I'm so excited to share it with the world. And I truly believe that fun can change our lives and the world for the better. So I'm so excited to get to talk to you about it.
Yeah, no, I mean, I am digging into it right now, and it's making me so excited as I'm going through it. And I love that story that you describe around that 1 hour, because I'm sorry, listeners, how many of you have done that where you're sitting? I know I have. I probably just did it yesterday, where you're sitting there and it's almost like, and I like how you catastrophized it too, because I'm with you on that one too. But with this power of fun, you know, you even went a step beyond that to give it its own label. Right? Because there is just kind of like fun, like we hear about self-care, let's go get a massage. But then there's this other category of fun, like you described, that really is rejuvenating. And like you come out of it feeling like a different person almost. So tell us more about kind of what that concept is.
Well, one of the things I realized when I was researching the book is that despite how often we use the word fun in our everyday lives, there's actually not a really good agreed upon definition of the term.
Right.
It's some, I mean, if you look it up in the dictionary, it's things like lighthearted pleasure. It's like, okay, fair enough. But that, or there's some really great ones, jollification, I guess that's a word. And then one I found, this has to be British. It was, the synonym for fun was beer and Skittles.
Like, I don't even know what British. To, I
agree. Right?
Like, it's not American.
It made no sense. But, you know, I mean, if you're having beer and Skittles as the best synonym for a word, you know, it's not a very well-defined word.
Yeah.
And at first I freaked out about that because it's like, okay, I'm writing a book about a word that no one's defined. And then I realized, ooh, that's an interesting opportunity. Like what is fun? And as I mentioned, one of my previous books was about vitamins. And the reason that came about is my husband one day turned to me out of the blue and goes, what's a vitamin? And I tried to answer him. And all I could think was vitamin C, scurvy, and like
the history of it, where it came from.
Yeah, but that was like all I had. And he's like, you should write a book about it. So it's a similar thing. I'm like, ooh, this is really interesting. Mm-hmm. And then I came to realize that the fact that we don't have a good definition of it has had some unintended consequences. One is that there's really not scientific research about fun. You got a lot about happiness and joy, these other concepts that are equally nebulous, but that people have put more work into nailing down a definition for, and therefore they've actually researched. Not so with fun. So that's fascinating to me. I mean, I was looking up, trying to find a, you know, research about fun on PubMed, and one of the top hits was an article about toenail fungus.
I remember that
fun in the book. Fungi. And I was like, not the kind of fun I'm talking about.
No.
But then the other thing I realized is that our lack of a solid definition leaves us vulnerable to any marketer that wants to market their products to us as fun, because we haven't thought about it.
Exactly.
And so we're like, oh, you told me that social media is fun, so I guess I'll spend all of my leisure time scrolling through pointless memes and things on other people's feeds that actually make me feel bad about myself, but it's fun.
Yeah.
Or like you're saying, things that truly are rejuvenating or restorative, like getting a massage or taking a bath or, you know, reading curled up in bed, but are not necessarily fun. So all that is to say, I started to really try to hone in on what is this feeling that I'm getting in my guitar class. And I came up with a hypothesis that I then ran by what I called the Fun Squad, which was this group of about, well, I don't even know how many people it is now, but it was like about 1500 people who signed up via my newsletter list to help me out with this experiment. And I asked them a question that I encourage your listeners to try as well, which was to call to mind three experiences from their own lives that they would describe as having been truly fun, where fun was the dominant descriptor. So if I asked you to tell me about it, you would say, that was so fun. I had so in capital letters.
Yeah.
And I didn't propose my definition. I had them each give me three examples of that. And then also an example of something they would like to plan for the future that would qualify as so fun. And I did that because I was doing this in the midst of lockdowns, like right in the beginning of the coronavirus pandemic. Yes. So it was kind of depressing to think back on fun and think I can't do that now. But anyway, and then only after that did I actually propose my definition to them and said, would this apply to what you just described? And my proposed definition is that fun is the confluence of three emotional states: playfulness, connection, and flow. So whenever we are in a state of playful, connected flow, that's what I would argue is when we were having what I call true fun. Yeah. And I call it true fun to distinguish it from what I call fake fun, which is this, the activities marketed to us as fun, but that actually leave us feeling hollow and vacant and empty after we do them, or gross about ourselves. They're kind of the junk food of fun. That's the fake fun.
That's a very good way to
put it. True fun leaves us feeling rejuvenated and restored and refreshed and energized and indeed feeling alive, which I think all of us could use more of right now.
Yeah. Yeah, no, absolutely. And I think, you know, number one, I love the fact that you wrap the science into it. Cause I've seen a lot of different books on joy and happiness and all of these other topics, right? But there's not the science to back it up, which I am a very big fan of, which sparks the question, you know, what's fun versus happiness then, right? Happiness is such a nebulous word. So give us kind of your two cents on that, because I think there needs to be a distinction, right?
Well, yes, I completely agree, because we all want to be happier, but
right.
As I think I say in the book, you know, saying we want to be happier or even have more fun, it's like, okay, how do you do that? You know, like I know how to have a croissant, or I know how to have
step by step
coffee date, but like, how do I have more fun, or how do I become happier? And one thing I love about the idea of fun is it's much more concrete to me than happiness is. But when we are having fun, I would argue we are universally happy. In our moments of fun, we're happy. And so what I came to conclude is that the path to happiness lies in the everyday pursuit of fun. And the more you can prioritize fun and note it when it happens and make it a point to build more of it into your life, the happier you will end up being without aiming directly at happiness. That's why the second half of the book is very much devoted to answering the question of how do you actually have more fun? But someone made a point to me when I was writing the book that I thought was very interesting. He said, you know, if you ask me if I'm happy, it's gonna be very difficult for me to answer. Like, that's a whole conversation, right? Yeah,
exactly.
What is happiness?
Yeah.
Am I happy? How gonna be? It just becomes philosophical very quickly. But if I say, hey, did you have fun last weekend?
Yeah.
You probably could tell me. Like,
yes,
you
or
just
no.
know, right? And so it's much more tangible to me. And I also think it's much more, once you drill down in the way that I try to do in the book and actually have techniques that you can use to invite more fun into your life. You can't guarantee you're gonna have fun because it is also an emotional nebulous state that could just run away.
Kind of right.
Like exactly. Can't force it. Yeah. But you can do things that are like, oh, I can set the stage for fun. And then you can know, rest assured, that if you do end up having fun, or even if you achieve any of those three states, if you have more moments of playfulness, or if you have more moments of human connection, or if you find yourself in more moments of flow, which is defined as the state of being so engrossed in whatever it is you're doing that you actually lose track of time, it's a really active and engaged state, then you're probably also going to be closer to being happy without having to obsess over happiness. So I've found for me that just my personal pursuit of fun has resulted in me being happier, but I no longer obsess over whether I'm happy or not because I just am
happy. Because it's just a state of being, right? Like it's the, it's the result of the things that you just described. And I think there's one point in the book where you speak about kind of a situation where you were biking like over mountains and all crazy places. And you said, I didn't think I would find it there because you were exhausted. So can you tell us a little bit about that? Because I think that's where that kind of connectedness, the playfulness, the intersection of things kind of happens too, right?
Yeah, I think there's lots of moments where we might have what seems like an uncomfortable or unpleasant experience in the moment, but that if you reflect on it, actually did have elements of fun. So to back up a bit, one suggestion I give to people in terms of how to begin to have more fun is to recognize the moments that may already exist in your life that you're just not actually labeling, and therefore you're not appreciating and you're not benefiting from as much as you could be. Because for my own life, I found this to be true. When I was writing the book, I was focusing very much on what I think of as peak fun experiences. These life-changing moments that you'll remember for the rest of your life of fun because they were so fun. But then I realized, wait, that's setting the bar pretty high. Yes, I want to aim for those moments, but I actually am having a lot of moments, even during the pandemic, of playfulness, connection, or flow. And sometimes they're occurring independently. Sometimes they're happening just with two of them, like playful flow or flow and connection. And sometimes they're happening all three of them together in contexts I would never think of. And if I actually label them, I began to become curious, would that make a difference in my perception of my own life? And I found, yes, it actually really does. So what you were talking about is an experience I had in college where I did a 63-day bike trip where we bicycled across the whole United States. I hitchhiked a lot.
That's a lot of miles.
A lot of miles. But you know, it was grueling. We biked over the Rockies. I mean, and across all sorts of other mountain ranges because America tilts upwards. If you go east to west, don't do it that way. It's all uphill. Kansas is actually all uphill if you go in that.
Hence the hitchhiking, folks.
But, you know, it was a time before cell phones, right before cell phones. So we all were just present. It was 30 people. It was some of my closest friends. We had no goals other than to get to our destination. And we had a lot of downtime and everyone had a good sense of humor. We were connected. We certainly were in flow. We were present with one another and we were all very playful. And if I look back on that, I laughed every single day. And I think that actually laughter is a very good sign that you're having fun. If you're having genuine laughter, not laughing at someone else, but real. And you can tell when people are having fun, I think is the other thing I've noticed. If you look at photos of people, you can tell when they're having fun. And to me, at least, there's something very joyful about it, but there's also something that makes my tears come to my eyes because it really, you see people in their best selves just being exuberant. But anyway, it just one example of like a moment that I did not expect to be fun. Once I started reflecting on it, I had to get a cortisone shot for my shoulder because I was having shoulder issues. And I'd had a bad experience with the radiologist for an MRI. This was just horrible. Like there was like dye exploding off, out of the skin. I was like, please don't let it be that guy. It has to be a different guy. This is that pen. There's a lot. Anyway, same radiologist walks in and I'm
gosh.
And he starts to introduce himself to me again. I'm like, we've met before. And it turned into this absurd experience that was indeed physically uncomfortable. But there was something so absurd about it. And I did feel connected with the three people, the radiologist and these assistants in the room. And I was certainly in flow. And I left and I was like, you know what? I actually think I just had fun. That was objectively unpleasant, but I had fun. And it made me think and realize that if we start to look for it in the same way that we currently look for things that upset us, there's actually way more positive things or opportunities to put a positive spin on experiences we're already having, which all is to say that in addition to seeking out these moments of peak fun that we can talk about ways to, you know, set the stage for, it's also really worth just paying attention to your daily life to see what's already there. And I actually recommend people keep what I call a fun times journal, where you reflect at the end of the day, perhaps during some of the time you're currently spending scrolling through your phone, on moments that you had of playfulness or connection or flow, or two of them. And if all three happen, circle it, because you were probably having true fun. And then notice, like, where were you? What were you doing? Who were you with, right? Because those can give you hints of other things to try. I call those your personal fun magnets, the things that each of us, our collection of activities, people, and settings that are most likely to put each of us into this state of playful, connected flow.
Yeah, no, I like the mindfulness piece of it, right? Like once you start to kind of have these parameters around it, once you start to notice it more, it reminds me of a gratitude practice, kind of same thing where you start noticing it more, identifying it more, and then it's automatically kind of comes into your life. And it's not, to your earlier point, something that's architected for us or spoon-fed to us. It is something that's in our control. And I think, you know, what you said about being able to see it on other people, you know, is such a strong point, because we all can relate to that. We all can relate to those moments where of, you know, looking at a picture and seeing just that freeness about somebody, which would you kind of consider kind of that, you know, that, you know what I'm speaking about? Would that kind of be in like the flow state of things, like having the kind of that free airiness where you're not thinking and you're just kind of more doing?
Yes, I think that's definitely indicative of flow. But in the photographs, it's more than that, because it's just it's the playful connected part as well. And as you're speaking, I'm just thinking it's really interesting because none of the photographs I'm referring to were things I saw on social media, for example. Right. That you just can tell in the vast majority of situations on social media that it's not really genuine, because most of the time when people are truly having fun, they're not taking
pictures. Not thinking it. No.
It's normally like someone else happened to capture it on camera and you look at it. Like, for example, this is shocking to me because this is not anything I thought I would do, but it's a result of my pursuit of fun. I've started playing the drums at open, and I even have my drum pad next to us on the table.
Michelle. That's awesome.
and playing at open mics with some of my music classmates, because that one decision to take that guitar class has introduced me to this whole community of people I never otherwise would have met. And if you look at the pictures of us at these open mics, you can tell. And actually there was a picture that actually a friend of mine did take at the last open mic that we were sending to a classmate who wasn't able to be there tonight. And it is actually a selfie that this guy took, but it's in this moment where, I mean, I just keep calling this photo up on my phone to look at again and again, because if you look at us in this picture, you can tell we are so happy.
It evokes the emotion.
Fun. And it's just so obvious. So I don't really know what the point is other than to say, like, you'll know it when you see it. And when you see it, I just encourage everyone to look for it, because even just seeing someone else have true fun can make you feel a little bit more alive yourself and make you want to feel that for yourself too. So I think it's really, I guess that goes to my broader point that I think there truly is power in fun, and that it can bring us closer to other people, people we already know and love, but also total strangers. And in this age of, you know, polarization and just people getting divided into tribes, I think that it's more important than ever to really tap into forces that can remind us that fundamentally we are all human beings who want the same things and who deserve to feel alive. And it's really,
It's another common denominator, right? Because I think you see a lot of times, like you just said, those common things that divide us, right? And put us into those tribes and put us into those groups, right? But fun or love or, you know, certain things are also common denominators across us all. But what you're describing to me also kind of brings up, you know, I was taught because I have a theater degree, you know, so I did a lot of work in the arts, but the arts for political purposes or economic development purposes. And they always taught about the tie around evoking emotion, right? And, you know, fun just seems in the way that you've the way that you've defined it to be just another criteria to see myself in you, for you to see yourself in me, to evoke those common emotions like we were just talking about, which is just an absolutely beautiful thing, right? I mean, what harm could happen of any of this? None. Right.
That's what's so beautiful about fun, I think, is that most of the time when we try to do self-improvement efforts, they require some degree of self-restraint or willpower.
Boundary.
eat more healthily. I'm going to exercise more. I'm going to meditate every day for 20 minutes. But fun is like going on a diet where the whole point is to eat more of the foods you love. You know, the challenge is identifying those foods, making space for them, but then binge, please, you know, And you make me think in terms of fun's power to connect us with other people. Just of an anecdote or a story I recently experienced myself is I was asked to be on this podcast, The Happiness Lab, with Lori Santos. And we're staging what we called a funtervention. And there was this very funny moment where she invited me to do it. She really loves sing-alongs. This was one of her fun magnets. It's kind of like karaoke, but you're not performing. You're all just singing along.
That's great.
And she invited me to do this with her. And I was like, I have to say yes, because I'm supposedly the fun person, right? But wait, we're going to do what? We're going to sit in your brightly lit living room, just the two of us, because it's COVID. Sing. And we're going to sing, and you're going to record it for your podcast. Oh my God. But then I'm like, I have to say yes. So she's like, do you mind if I turn down the lights? I'm like, no, I don't mind. Turn down the light. Please turn down the light.
Put me in the dark.
Yeah, put me in the dark. And she's got this playlist of like 30 songs, like so many songs, you know, and I'm just thinking, oh my God. And I took a deep breath, and she starts playing the first song, and it was Toto's Africa, that song.
Oh gosh, that's awesome.
You know, I hear the drums echoing tonight. And I was like, I took a breath and I started singing. And as soon as the first words came out of my mouth, I was like, I am having so much fun.
Yeah.
This is
yeah.
so fun. Like, she had to kick me out. We had to switch laptops to get an extra playlist. And I bring that up because it's like, we had a perfectly nice relationship before that, you know, friendly relationship, but we're like friends now because we shared two and a half hours of belting out like 80s hits and 90s boy bands together and losing ourselves in this fun that I don't think that any kind of team building exercise we possibly could have done would have had the same results as just being willing to both go all in, like lose our self-consciousness.
Yeah.
And have this fun experience together.
That's just that's absolutely amazing. And now I have just so many cool visuals, and like, I'm envisioning you having that level of fun, which is another level of connection, right?
Yes. Well, she was like, do you want an inflatable microphone or an inflatable guitar? And I'm sitting there thinking, oh my God, like I am not good at charades. I am not playing an air guitar. Do not give me that guitar. I'll take the microphone. Thank you. Yeah. But now I'm like, oh, it's actually, wait, Michelle, this is so fun. This is a thumb drive. And I don't know if you can see, it says sing-along on it, because she gave this to me afterwards so I could have the songs. And this is a treasured possession now. This is fun in a thumb drive.
I know, right? And but imagine if you could bottle it like that, number one. Right? It would be the highest selling commodity on the planet, probably. We would like, you know, outsell so many of their non-optimal things to be selling.
Yeah, we'll say right now. Out there, bottle fun.
Yeah. Right. I don't know. But I think also, you know, one point that you kind of just spoke about was that fear that happens before the fun moment, right? Because we get stuck. And I see this a lot of times when I ask clients, like, well, what's your definition of your ideal life? And they look at me like deer in headlights, like they forget they have a choice, right? So there's all, sometimes it's going to be that fear, right? You must have seen like before people jump into fun, like what you just described, like, oh my gosh, I'm going to puke before I get up and sing, you know, in a sing-along, you know, that kind of thing. So how do you recommend people deal with that?
I think it's two things. I think the first thing is that we legitimately don't know what even to think of doing. So that's the first challenge.
Oh, yes. And agreed.
I hear that all the time from people. I don't even remember how to have fun anymore. I mean, the same thing I was facing.
Yeah.
I was sitting on the couch.
Absolutely.
Like, you know, you get wrapped up in your adult responsibilities and fun gets to the bottom of the priority list. Or if you have kids, maybe you prioritize their fun. You're arranging play dates for them. You're taking them to birthday parties, but you're just standing around on the sidelines having awkward small talk with other parents, or maybe checking your phone, you know, or like answering work emails while they're off tap dancing. That's not fun.
That's, so I think that's not fun.
Not fun. So I think the first step is to set aside some undistracted time, which probably is going to require putting your phone away, to actually ask yourself, what did you love to do when you were a kid? What's something that you supposedly want to do, but always say you don't have time for? Because guess what? We're spending an average of 4 hours a day on our phones. That was before the pandemic. And granted, some of it's for work, but a lot of that is not. So there's actually more time than we think. And then, you know, think big and small. Maybe there's something new you'd like to try. Novelty is a great conduit for fun. But maybe there's also just things that might not lead to the full-on state of playful connected flow that I referred to, because normally that does require human connection, even for introverts, which is, side note, also fascinating.
Yeah.
But maybe you have hobbies that you haven't set aside time for in a long time, or passions or interests or something you want to learn more about. You know, just asking yourself, What are you interested in? And then also, what makes you feel joyfully alive? So you got to have some ideas for that. And again, that's why I recommend that you write down three experiences from your past that did match that description, and also start to track playfulness, connection, and flow in your everyday life, because that's when you can start getting a sense of what are these themes that emerge. So for Lori Santos, for example, she doesn't play an instrument, and she said she never would have thought that music would be a thing for her. But when she started to go through her past experiences of true fun, there was a musical theme that emerged. Yeah. There were music involved in nearly all of them. And she was really surprised by that. And that's what led her to, you know, suggest a sing-along with me. And then getting to your question, to the second part of your question, once you realize that, it can seem scary, right? Because I think for several reasons. One is adults, actually, let me back up. There's a great book by Tom Vanderbilt called Beginners, and it's about the importance of trying new things.
Yeah.
And he just talks about how he joins a choir as part of this book. And he just talks about how, you know, if you're a third grader and you're singing a solo and you're not very good at it, there's kind of, there's an acceptance.
Not when you're an adult out there.
Yeah, you go up as an adult and you are bad at something and people are like really feeling very uncomfortable for you. Yeah. It's just really different. So we're less forgiving of ourselves and of other people as adults when we're not good at something. But that doesn't mean we shouldn't do stuff. I think that there's real empowerment that comes from not caring if you're good and letting go of perfectionism. And I would also say that one of the many unintended side effects and consequences of social media is that it's made that even worse, where we are looking at other people's supposedly perfect lives. We're looking at them do things perfectly. I mean, if I were to watch YouTube videos of five-year-olds playing piano, I'm sure I'd feel horrible about myself because there's a lot of prodigies out there. And also no one posts anything to YouTube of their first try or when they suck.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of fake, like quote unquote, evidence of people doing that are better than us. So it's really easy to feel inferior. And we also are naturally less likely to be willing to go out on a limb as adults because it's less accepted and encouraged, but there's such freedom in it. And I think finding context in which you feel okay not being perfect and not being an expert is incredibly important. And for me, that's what this musical community has been. You know, I would never want to perform anything if I thought that it actually mattered. If like I was trying to do a concert or a recital or whatever, I'd probably could. But doing something where it's low key and I know that I'm with friends and that we're all just doing it for fun allows me to feel free and to enjoy myself. And I just, I guess I would say if anyone's kind of on the edge and not sure whether they should try it, it is worth it. You know, do something little, like start small. You don't have to do something hugely dramatic. And Tom Vanderbilt makes a really interesting point, I think, also in his book and in interviews I've heard him give, where he says that it is, as adults, we'll say things like for example, for me, I'm not a drummer.
Yeah.
You know, I never learned to play the flute, right? And it's like, and one thing, I've got a six-year-old, we always say to her is to put a dot, 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 yet on the end of these things. Yeah. You know, I can't do blah yet. And it's like, okay, so I'm not an excellent drummer yet. But first of all, who says I have to be excellent?
Exactly.
And second, why did I just say that I'm not that? Like, that's not part of my identity. Why can't I change my identity in my 40s? Like, why is that not a thing? Yeah. So that I think has been another side effect, a positive side effect of fun for me, is opening up this world of possibilities of things I can do and try and just not caring about how good I am, because that's not the point.
Yeah. Yeah. I think, I mean, as an adult, like, let's think about how many things we do where we're not driving to some sort of desired outcome, right? Like, I mean, they're very few and far between when you think about it, right? Like, we're either going to a park to create our kids' memories, right? Like, we're planning vacations for, like, which are actually trips when you're a parent, not a vacation. You know, so there's all these different things that are kind of always have an outcome or always goal oriented, especially for folks who are overachievers, right? So just being able to, I mean, I know for myself, just being able to do something for the sake of doing it does scare the crap out of me, right? Like, and it makes me super uncomfortable, but I like the fact that you couple it with look back first and just remember what that felt like, because we do get locked and loaded in our lives, right? Like, it's almost like there's an invisible line where you're like, oh, you've reached this certain point. You're not allowed to change anything, move anything, or make any other decisions. You're now on autopilot, go, right? Like right. Just, that itself is scary, even more scary.
Honestly, that means you're dead. Like,
well, right. Like, yeah.
You're never going to change. You're never going to try anything new. Like, this is the last version of yourself you're ever going to be. I don't want to live like that. No. Like, I want to be constantly changing and growing and experiencing and feeling alive. And for me, that's trying new things. And sometimes they're disasters. Like just this morning, I was reflecting on this improv comedy class I took when I was in my 20s. Cause I kind of compulsively say yes to things. Oh my goodness. I don't get embarrassed easily. That class was so bad. So bad. I can get embarrassed more than 20 years ago. I am embarrassed to think about it now, but I mean, it was totally worth it. Right? Like I don't want to do it again. It took me a long time to realize I didn't have to do it again. Cause my instinct was, oh, I better double down and try more.
Exactly. Classes. Get it right.
Didn't get it right. I didn't get an A in that. But no, you know, so you might have an embarrassing experience, but you'll have had an experience instead of just like looking through other people's fake experiences on their phones. But you made me think of something in terms of, you know, giving ourselves permission or how strange it can feel to do something just for ourselves is that as part of my book in the second half, I have this acronym called or this system I call SPARK, how to spark fun. Yeah. And the R in SPARK stands for rebel. And the idea is that many of our fun moments happen in times when we do something that's a little bit out of what we think we're supposed to be doing. Because when I started looking through the anecdotes that were shared with me by this fun squad, by the people who were helping me research the book, there was this theme of this playful rebellion, just slight deviance where they would do something a little bit out of the ordinary, you know, not like steal a car or.
Or no, like hey, have a late bedtime.
Yeah, exactly. It also made me realize, oh man, grown-ups are really lame because it would be just like 2 hours late talking to a friend. And it's like, oh wow, that's really sad. But but it made me realize that just doing some things that are slightly out of the ordinary or slightly go against what's quote expected of us, or just allowing like our inner playful spirit out, that feeling of playful deviance actually adds to the fun. And I think there's many opportunities for us to incorporate more of that into our daily lives. And one of my favorite examples of that I do all the time myself is that at some point in the past 5 years, let's not say when, but I decided that listening to the news was just stressing me out too much.
Me too.
I didn't want my daughter to listen to it. I just didn't want to be listening to the news. So I actually stopped listening to the news. Nothing bad has happened as a consequence of this. And instead, when I'm alone in the car in particular, I put on music that I really want to sing along to.
Yeah.
Like I got a lot of Hamilton things going on, right?
Me too. Me too.
This morning I was trying to yodel. I was listening to Hank Williams and I spent a good 25 minutes just driving around Philadelphia trying to yodel to Long Gone Lonesome Blues. And dear God, I hope that there wasn't a secret recording device in my car. But my point is that like that was totally for myself and not what a quote, well, normal or responsible adult might do for 20 minutes in their middle of their Tuesday. But it was fun. Like I enjoyed that moment. So I guess what I'm saying is seek out little moments where you can do something that makes you feel self-indulgent, because self-indulgence is really important for us actually.
Yeah.
But if you feel like a teensy bit naughty about it, chances are it will also feel a little bit fun. So that's one of my favorite tips for incorporating more fun into your life.
Yeah. Which is, I mean, that is fantastic. We can all do it. I think I'm 100% on board with the not listening to the news thing. Right. I'm guilty of listening to too many educational things, right? Like I want to teach myself something and I want to maximize every moment that I'm in a car. But to your point, yeah, Hamilton is kind of my go-to on that too.
Well, that reminds me actually of something someone from the fun squad said in one of the survey responses. She said, you know, as a result of doing this experiment with you, I've started thinking about what I use my leisure time for and how it makes me feel. And she said, I noticed that I have a tendency to pack my schedule with these things I've labeled for myself as quote fun.
Yeah.
But when I really think about it, they're not fun. I'm doing like educational stuff, like attending lectures or going to talks or listening to podcasts that educate me in some way. And there's certainly a value in that, but it isn't quite classified as fun. And she said, I was wondering why I had been feeling so stressed out and overwhelmed. And then once I realized that actually I was classifying these things the wrong way, it really freed up the opportunity for me to make space for true fun and still do those other things, but in moderation and not feel bad about why she wasn't feeling really excited about them. Because in reality, it was self-improvement efforts. It wasn't kind of just giving herself opportunities for fun. Self-improvement can be fun too, but it was interesting to see.
No, and because I think a lot of the times those self-improvement efforts come from a place of something's broken or wrong with me too, right? Like I'm less than, right? Versus you're fine, break a rule a little bit and have lighten up, right? Like you hear that a lot. It's easier said than done, but I think it comes from a place of fun, comes from a place of you are already enough. Whereas kind of that self-improvement level comes from a place of I'm trying to fix something, anything. Yeah. Right?
And I think exploring like what already is good about you and yeah. your life and what can you do to enjoy it more? Why constantly be searching for problems? I mean, they actually have a line in my book that's like, we are not problems waiting to be fixed yeah. or lives waiting to be lived.
Yeah.
And that happens right now. And it is happening right now, you know? Right. So shifting our focus that way, I think can be really helpful. And just giving yourself permission to enjoy your own life. I think that's another point that's important to keep in mind, because one of the frequent criticisms of fun as well, that would be nice, but you know, there's a lot of serious problems
exactly.
and we should be working to improve them. And I completely agree. There are a lot of serious problems, but first we need to fill up our own tanks before we'll have the energy to exactly. do anything else. And then second, again, by bringing us closer with other human beings, fun is the capacity to transcend a lot of the arguments and the fights that we currently are having and allow us to work cooperatively towards solving these bigger problems.
Yeah.
So I thought that was interesting for myself to recognize that, like, I'm a more effective person, I'm more productive, I'm more creative, I'm more resilient when I'm having fun. And so yeah. therefore it's not frivolous at all. It's actually, I would say, essential for my mental and my physical health, and therefore yeah. should be top of my priority list.
Yeah. And I mean, whoever is kind of coming to you with that, rebuttal around like there's serious things in the world. Well, you know, I'm a big fan of like both have to coexist. Like you just said, like you can't have dark without light. You can't have, you know, yin yang, all of that stuff. And so often we like to just put them in buckets and throw the one that we don't like in that moment away. Right. So I think it's extremely, you know, helpful what you're putting out in the world today. Like,
Thank you.
A reminder.
I think there's a quote from John Cleese that was something like, it's impossible to basically have a fight with someone if you're laughing uproariously together.
Yeah.
You know, if you can create that connection, you will find other ways to connect.
Yes.
And yeah. if you have, actually, it reminds me, there was a book called Humor Seriously, which is a interesting read. And there's anecdotes in that about, it was Madeleine Albright and her Soviet counterpart or Russian counterpart. And they're like in this high diplomacy thing, but there also is a talent show. Mm-hmm. And they somehow like set aside time to figure out how to do this skit that involved, I want to say, an electric guitar and a performance of rewritten awesome. Lyrics to some song,
yeah.
which from the outside might at first seem like, why are you wasting your time? You're supposed to be doing serious things. You're supposed to be solving the world's crises. And it's like, wait a second, if you do that and you have that ridiculous experience with this person, you're seeing them as a human, you're having fun together, that will help you at the diplomacy table. So yeah. I just think we forget that sometimes the path through the darkness is to emphasize the light.
Yes. Oh my gosh. Can you just say that again? The path through the darkness is to what, my dear? Please.
Emphasize the light. Lean Thank into the light. You. Bring Thank the light. You.
Exactly. Be the light. All of the things
Be
about
the
light.
Light,
folks.
All the light verbs. Actually, yeah. and another thing that reminds me of is to seek delight, which is one of my favorite yeah. suggestions. Which is inspired by this other book called The Book of Delights, appropriately enough, by the poet Ross Gay. And this guy wrote an essay for a whole year, every day, about something that delighted him. And it inspired me to, going back to what you were saying about the idea of mindfulness and a gratitude practice, which is a validated way to boost our moods, but it can feel a little like, all right, I got to list the things I'm grateful for.
Exactly. Yeah.
So I've started doing this delight practice and just noticing things that delight me in the, like today I was at the dermatologist and there was this like Halloween pumpkin with, This is not going to sound delightful, but they were little 3D models of the coronavirus, but they were in red and green. And I was like, I'm not sure if I'm delighted by this, but there's something kind of delightful, but like weird about the fact that we've got like Christmas themed coronavirus.
Christmas / Halloween confused coronavirus.
Yeah. Like virus things. I'm like the absurdity of that delights me. And anyway, so the practice is that when you notice something that delights you, you put a finger in the air and you say delight out loud. And that actually is a validated technique in positive psychology to boost your mood, to notice the positive, call attention to it with a physical gesture and say it out loud. And ideally with someone else. So actually I've got delight text chains going on with some of my friends where we just text each other. I think it's a good use of technology, pictures of things that delight us. Great. I actually have a bracelet on my wrist that says delight on it as a way to remind myself to focus on the delights. But I love that as just a very simple way to bring a bit more positivity and light to your own life. Recognize the good that's already out there. Because you can imagine the effects that the opposite would have, right? If I had an anxiety practice and I was like, anxiety, or like I don't know.
Depression.
Humanity.
Hate. What else are we going to do? I mean, maybe that might spark some interesting conversations if we were calling that as we see it.
But less fun.
Less fun, a little bit more conflict filled, which maybe we need, I don't know. There's a lot of things that we need in this world, but I think what you just described here, to kind of come full circle right now, we're in the holiday season, folks. This episode is coming out and this is the gift, of fun, folks. So why not, take advantage of it. So do you have any kind of last points, because it is the holidays, right? Perfect time also, I would think, to go back and look at previous holidays and pinpoint some places where there was actual true fun, right? But any other kind of last bits that you want to throw in here around the holidays?
Yes. I think one of my slogans for myself is let's make the holidays fun again, because we didn't get to see our loved ones last year.
You're going to get hats for that too.
Yeah, exactly. All brand of merchandise.
Exactly.
So I think we're out of practice of socializing to begin with, and then the holidays we didn't get to celebrate with people. So I do have suggestions. I actually have a lot of resources at howtohavefun.com that people can sign up for my newsletter. And I'm sending out stuff around this in particular, including conversation starting things such as a fun compatibility quiz, where you can actually print it out and do it with your loved ones around the holiday table as a conversation prompt and something to talk about besides politics or the coronavirus or whatever else might kind of derail your conversation.
Yeah.
I say in general, just a couple quick suggestions for making the holidays fun again, is that one of the biggest problems when it comes to having fun is distraction. Is anything that distracts us pulls us out of our present moment, but we can only have fun when we're in flow, which requires us to be in the present moment. So any distraction is going to pull us out of flow and therefore prevent us from having true fun. End stop. It just can't happen. And one of the biggest impediments to our ability to be in flow right now is our devices. So I think it's very worthwhile to ask your guests and yourself to put away their phones and devices while you're together at the table, or even while you're gathering in general, so that you can be present and then have more opportunities for fun. Then give them an alternative, because people have gotten into the habit of using technology to self-soothe, and you take that away and they're going to be anxious. So one thing I actually love doing, and this will sound totally forced, but I promise it actually can work, is to provide people with conversation prompts. So for example, like at holidays, I like to put a question. I mean, there's lots of conversation prompts you can get online, but a question under each person's plate, and then go around the table during the meal. Answer that. And it's a wonderful way to bridge or create connections between different generations too. Yeah. Even a question that's kind of ostensibly silly, such as like, what was your go-to outfit when you were a teenager, can actually be really interesting and fun to find out what your grandfather would answer to that question versus who's currently a teenager. You can also do something like just put a single word under people's plates, like love or gratitude or kindness or fun, and ask people to reflect on what that word means to them that week or that day. That can be interesting. And then if you've got people who actually don't know each other well, one of my favorite things is to actually do name tags. But in addition to your name, have people answer some simple questions. So for example, at a party I did this fall, I just had people write down their favorite thing about fall under the name. And that was really interesting, because it gave what I consider to be kind of conversational handholds or like grips to grab onto, so that you have something to talk about. That's not just, oh, how do you know the host?
Yeah, oh, or the weather.
How's the weather? And that was kind of fun, one of my acquaintances had, it was like, his name was Arthur, and then it said fall fashion. And I was like, tell me about fall fashion, Arthur.
Exactly.
And it was a fun little conversation. So I guess what I'm saying is to try to reduce distractions and then replace those distractions with little props that can facilitate connection and therefore are more likely to lead to interactions that at very least will be instances of playfulness, connection, or flow. And in the best case scenario, might amount to a combination of all three.
Yeah. I mean, I can already feel like that feeling of sitting around the table and everybody laughing collectively. And, that scenario you just described with like a grandfather versus like a granddaughter, and just, and how often do we get to do those nowadays? I mean, Zoom is great, but, having people back around a table will be amazing.
Well, that's the other thing. I think also like setting an intention, even a question like what's something that everyone actually, I call them fun magnets, the activities, settings, and people that typically bring fun. Go around the table and talk about what those are for each person, and then make a commitment around your table that everyone's going to try one of those in the next month or so, and then report back. I mean, there's many different ways to bring this into a conversation that would both make the conversation itself more enjoyable and also potentially jumpstart future fun.
Yeah. Yeah. And jumpstart the awkwardness, because that is a thing right now. I mean, I found myself at a holiday event this past weekend and I was like, I don't know how to talk to people anymore. like in real life.
Like, oh, so yeah. Wow. Pandemic. Crazy. You know, you're like, God, I just want to be back home in my pajamas because this is more painful than not.
Yeah, exactly.
Fun is the antidote.
Fun is the antidote. I agree. Well, tell people, you know, the date it's coming out so they can pre-order it, where they can find it, all of that good stuff about you, my dear.
Oh, thank you for the opportunity.
Yeah.
So the book is coming out December 21st. Although apparently there's a global paper shortage. So depending on when you're listening to this, please pre-order it. It would be enormously helpful to me. And if you do pre-order it, it will come in time for Christmas. And can be, I truly think, a great holiday gift. Cause as I said, the second half is all about how to have fun, and it's designed to be more fun if you do it with other people. And you can find out more about the book and more about me at howtohavefun.com and or screenlifebalance.com. So whichever one you remember will get you some similar information, but I've got all sorts of resources, conversation prompts, quizzes, like fun personality type finder, and a quiz that's called Why Aren't You Having Fun? which also can be a fun conversation prompt if you want to do that at the holidays with your loved ones. But
Yeah. I mean, and folks, like if you for some reason miss the holiday, that holiday, there's New Year's, right? So when you're setting resolutions or any of that stuff, why not make one of them fun, folks? Come on. Like, why not?
Oh, actually, I was going to say, I've also decided, I think I was telling you this, I've decided to proclaim February as the least fun month of the year because it's so cold, at least in the Northeast, and it's dark and it's short and there's not the holidays to look forward to, but spring isn't there yet. So I'm doing a funtervention, massive funtervention in February. So if you follow me on social media, I will use it as a force for good and sign up for my newsletter, howtohavefun.com. I'll keep you in the loop, and hopefully we'll have a huge group of people around the world committing themselves to making February fun.
That's amazing. Well, you know what, Catherine, I'm on board. Count me in for fun. I'm going to write my past things down. I'm going to finish the book and all that stuff. And I'm going to be gifting it to quite a few people this holiday season as well. So, you know, thank you for giving us the gift of fun today, Catherine.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. This has been such a pleasure. So much fun, in fact.
I know, right? Fun.